what you are, it's realizing what you actually are. And the one who realizes what they actually are recognizes their need. We're in Revelation chapter 19 this evening. Revelation 19. Last week we looked at Babylon and asked and answered some interesting questions, but the fall of Babylon, the lament of Babylon has lamented. My intent is not to be controversial, but I do think that anyone who just studies the scriptures as they're written, outside of the interpretation of the commentators, would recognize that to interpret Babylon as being Rome, as with really one basis, that is that it's a city set on seven hills, which is to, at the same time, ignore Jerusalem also being known as the city set on seven hills as well. A person who would say, well, this is the Roman Catholicism, does a couple of things. First, negates the evil of any religion aside from Catholicism. In other words, Catholicism is the bad religion, is the all-inclusive, powerful, evil religion, and everything else is, you know, overlooked, in a sense, by God. And I don't think that's so, but it's, as you study and you look at the Scripture, one of the things that you find is that if you take the Scripture literally, then Babylon is Babylon. Matter of fact, the parallel passage to Revelation 18 would be the last couple of chapters, Jeremiah 51, 52, almost the same language, almost the same prophecies, and that's right before the Babylonian captivity of Judah. And so I would submit to you that because of the events that have to take place with Jerusalem before Babylon's final demise, that Babylon is Babylon. And I think we would do well when the Bible says this was like or this was the same as or similar to realize that this is an illustration of something. But when the Bible says this is this, then the Bible means what it says. If you want to start playing the game of allegorizing the Scripture, there you'll find that everybody plays by different rules when you play that game. And you'll find that there's a lot of ability to just take the Bible to mean whatever it says, whatever you want it to say. And one, there can't be any unity in interpreting the Scripture, not so much that that's the only driving force or reason. But the reality of it is that the Bible says that there is no private interpretation. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. And that's a fact. In other words, the Bible doesn't, God doesn't say something to you and something else to me, something to someone, to one individual and something to another. The Bible, God says what He means, and His intent is for those individuals that are spiritually minded to read it for what it is intended to say and to come under its authority, not to interpret it. And so we are to understand it, not interpret it. The Scripture isn't private interpretation. We're to believe it. Okay, so let's pick up this evening, and we are turning a corner. This is another after these things. By the way, the word after, what tense is it? Okay, well, what comes... Okay, so after these things. So, yeah, it's after this is over, then this begins. So, again, we're seeing a new scene. We're seeing another angel coming down from heaven. Verse 19. And we'll read to verse 9. And after these things, I heard a great voice of much people in heaven saying, Alleluia! Salvation and glory and honor and power unto the Lord our God. Handel got... He's a plagiarizing musician. He kind of... ripped off a lot of Revelation, but he ripped out a bunch from Revelation 19. Verse 2, for true and righteous are His judgments, for He hath judged the great whore, which did corrupt the earth with her fornication, and hath avenged the blood of His servants at her hand. And again they said, Hallelujah, and her smoke rose up forever and ever. And the 24 elders and the four beasts fell down and worshipped God that sat on the throne, saying, Amen, Hallelujah. And a voice came out of the throne, saying, Praise our God, all ye servants, and ye that fear Him, both small and great. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of mighty thundering, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. How many of you like Handel's Messiah, by the way? It's my favorite piece of music, and I love this part of the Messiah. And as magnificent as that actually is, it really is, I think that's probably the finest piece of music ever written. If you're a musician, you appreciate music. It's just, when it's well done, it's magnificent. Can you imagine what this sound is like? I mean, John is describing a multitude out of heaven, and they're singing. I mean, a heavenly chorus of just, I mean, I just can't imagine what the host of singing must be, but this has got to be the most just overwhelming. You ever hear music that is just, you know, when the bass violin is playing, and then you have 30, 40, 50 stringed instruments playing, and you have everybody toward the climax of that, and that just can do nothing in comparison with this scene. This just gives me chills as I read the words, and it's just beyond the imagination, I believe. So verse 6, I heard as it were the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of mighty thundering, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord, it's hard to just read it with that, for the Lord God omnipotent, but it's amen. Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. And if you can think of the relief to all those in the world who have looked for the coming kingdom of the Messiah. I mean, not those who have pretended to look for the coming kingdom of the Messiah, but for those who have lived for the coming kingdom of the Messiah, when the multitude from heaven opens up, and the multitude from heaven says, for the Lord God omnipotent, not will reign, reigneth. It's on. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to Him, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and His wife hath made herself ready. Verse 8, and to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. And again, the reminder here is that our fine linen is given to us, and our fine linen is earned for us by the washing, the cleansing nature of the blood of Jesus Christ. And he saith unto me, write, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, these are the true sayings of God. And it's interesting, isn't it, that God says, these are the true sayings of God. There's just an angel speaking for God, but this is God's word. And it's just like what it's reminiscent to me of Jesus when he would speak and he would say, verily, verily. If you ever study the word verily, it's an important word. It means this is extremely true, so true it cannot be untrue. And I've spoken it twice for sake of emphasis. In other words, God says it's so. And so here we see, these are the true sayings of God. God Himself. Well, let's pray. We'll ask the Lord to help us as we make some important observations from our text this evening. Father, please help us tonight. Lord, help me not to say more or less than needs to be said. Lord, this evening we need to be helped from controversy. It's not our it is not our desire or our prideful. We wouldn't be so prideful as to think that we could know answers to things that you do not say. So, Lord, let us look at your word this evening, looking at what is said, and let us apply and obey what you've said. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. A lot of people like to argue about the marriage supper of the Lamb. I'm not among them, to be quite truthful with you. There is some strange doctrine developed about the church, and the problem with it is that I remember hearing Baptist writers talking about the marriage supper of the Lamb when I was a child. And I remember hearing things that as a kid didn't make sense because there's so many contradictions in them. Now, I'll deal briefly with contradictions, but I'm not going to focus on that tonight, to be honest with you. I'm not going to talk about what the Scripture doesn't say. We'll talk about what the Scripture does say. I think that's way more helpful. You know, I found that many important passages of the Scripture that are hot points for debate among believers have nuggets of vital, practical truth that are overlooked for the debate. And so I'm not going to debate anybody about the marriage supper of the Lamb this evening. If you claim to know precisely all the events of the marriage supper of the Lamb, you claim to know something the Bible doesn't even tell us. And I don't want to be overly simplistic, but let me just put it that way as helpfully as I can. If you're an ultra-dispensationalist, I'm a dispensationalist. I don't apologize for that. God has, in divers manners, in sundry time, dealt with people in different ways. But salvation has always been by, hope you know, by faith, right? If you've been in our Sunday morning series for the last 6 months or so, we've been preaching through Romans. One of the strong points that Paul develops to help the Judaizers in the Roman church, the church at Rome, not the Catholic church, but in the church at Rome, one of the strong points that he uses is the illustration of Abraham and his salvation in Genesis 15. Abraham believed God, and his faith was counted for righteousness. One of the strong points the Holy Spirit uses in Hebrews to help believers to understand that salvation has always been the same is to illustrate that it is by faith. Hebrews 11, by faith, by faith, by faith. So how are we saved? How was Abraham saved? By faith. That's what the Bible says. Romans, Paul actually establishes it as a doctrine, a law. If you want to systematize the Scripture, there's the law of faith developed in Romans. And it's the means for salvation. It's plainly written. It's clearly understood. And the I guess you'd call it the roundhouse blow that Paul uses to illustrate the simplicity of salvation by faith is to those that would try to bring the Gentiles in the church under the law. Paul simply asks the question, when was Abraham saved by faith? Well, before Moses was ever born. When did we get the law? We got the law from Moses. So Paul said before Moses, or before the law, sin was in the world, centered into the world, and there was death. And so without the law, people sinned. Without the law, people died. And so the law isn't the means for salvation. It isn't the cause for death. And Paul then answers the question in many different ways, but one of the strong ways that he illustrates what the law is useful for is he illustrates, he says, the purpose of the law is to help to make sin exceedingly sinful. In other words, Paul would have said it this way, I had not known sin, except I'd known the law. And so what does the law do? Well, it helps to Galatians, it helps as to be a schoolmaster to us, to bring us to Christ. It has a purpose, but it doesn't save. How are we saved? By faith. Okay. So to any individual that would take the 24 elders in heaven and the multitudes in heaven and say that this is the church and that God is going to work through Israel, that would be an individual that doesn't realize that the church at this stage, as we know it, has been around for around 2,000 years. But that God has been working in the world for significantly longer than that. In other words, you leave behind the hosts in heaven. And we know they're in heaven. How do we know? Well, after Jesus was raised from the dead, you remember that the saints also came out of the graves. They went into the city of Jerusalem. Where'd they go after that? Well, they went up with Jesus. They ascended to heaven. The saints are no longer in paradise, where hell and paradise, as described in Luke 16, are separated by a gulf betwixt them. So the saints are in heaven. And if you read just the description in chapter 19, you see that these are the saints or the voices that are in heaven. And they're not segregated up there. There's not the, you know, Adamic covenant saints, and then the Noahic covenant saints, and the Abrahamic covenant saints, and the Mosaic covenant saints, and the Davidic covenant saints, all up in heaven. And then the church, you know, has, you know, a special room. You know, we told the Baptist joke a couple weeks ago. Remember that? Yeah, okay, so you know the Baptist joke about when one of this man died and went to heaven. Saint Peter was giving him the tour of the grounds. He was in one. They passed a real big room with a whole bunch of people in it, and he told him, shh, 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 quiet, and they tiptoed by. After they tiptoed by, he said, what was that? And he said, that's the Baptist. They think they're the only ones here. You know? And this would be a passage of Scripture where Baptists take to say, hey, we're the only ones here. My friend, I'm going to just tell you something. The saints have all been saved by faith. The object of faith has always been the same. It has always been Jesus Christ. Either looking toward Christ or looking back at what Christ has done, salvation has always been by faith. And you say, Pastor, I don't know about that. My friend, give some people credit for having some intelligence. Will you please? The seed of the woman. Scientifically, how clear is that? How clear is that a miraculous prophecy? It's crystal clear. I'm sorry, anybody that knows anything knows the seed comes from the man. We knows that the sin nature is passed by men, and it's prophetic of the virgin birth of Jesus Christ. And that's exactly the outline of Genesis. There's two lines in Genesis. There's fallen man, and there is the man that believes in the promise of God. And if you just look at the scripture, I'm just telling you something. Those folks, they weren't as ignorant as you may think. And so they knew what God said. They believed the promise of God. And it's very, very popular today to say, well, you know, there was a very incomplete picture of the redemption plan. Well, my friend, the New Testament does make things mighty clear, doesn't it? There's no questioning. There's no debating that. Matter of fact, you're cutting your legs out from under yourself to pull the New Testament out of your gospel presentation. I wouldn't do that. It's not an intelligent thing to do. But the fact of the matter is that the gospel's in the Old Testament all the way through.
Right.
And the gospel has always been salvation by faith. By faith in what? By faith in what God was going to do. The virgin birth was plainly, clearly prophesied throughout the scripture. But it was prophesied in right after we have the origins. The origin of man, the original fall of man, and then the promise of a Messiah, Genesis 3, 15 and 16. And so, I mean, the beginning of the scripture, there's the promise of the Messiah. And those who have been believers have always believed that promise by faith. Okay, so suffice it to say, I've spent more time on that than I actually intended this evening. But there isn't some division in heaven where, you know, okay, you Baptists get to go out and celebrate the marriage supper of the Lamb. Everybody else is excluded. Sorry. Or Israel or whatever. No, my friend, this is where everybody comes together. This is where you have those individuals which have been taken out to the hill of Armageddon, or the tail, this hill of Megiddo, and the 144,000 are there with the Lord Jesus, and now the host of heaven is coming for this marriage supper of the Lamb. Now, I want to point out some important things, though, that the Bible does teach about the about marriage and about the marriage supper, and I think that they're very helpful and make great illustrations. We know about the feast at Cana of Galilee. I think all of us, if we were to tell a story about the feast of Cana of Galilee, when maybe the first time we're really introduced to Jesus and his first miracle that is recorded was at the feast of Cana of Galilee. And so we know a little bit about what a wedding would have been like. We know that our Lord Jesus certainly would have participated in going to a Jewish wedding. Now, a Jewish wedding had three parts. It had the betrothal, that is where, and this should be this way today, by the way. Ladies, this is the right way to do it, gentlemen. Mom and dads of the, I'm only joking about this, okay. But mom and dad get together and they arrange the marriage and, you know, figure out how many goats or camels or, you know, whatever the penalty is for the marriage. And then that gets paid, you agree on it. And then the son goes home, and because he's going to inherit, did I say penalty?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yes, I did. I wanted to. Okay. Then the son goes home and builds a mansion or an apartment on his father's house, because the land would have been the inheritance that would have been important. And he goes and prepares a place for his wife, just like when Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. Same concept, same idea. So some would go and he would work on a house. And usually they would assume that would take about a year to finish building the house. I know if I liked the girl, I could probably build a good shack in probably a week or so. I know it would be an accelerated progress. But you'd want to build a nice one as well. And so the husband would be spending time preparing a place for his bride. I mean, it would be a big deal. He'd be, and I would hope in that time, trying to get to know her a little bit and really make the place a special place prepared for her. And so when she comes, she'd go, this is, you know, you want it to be everything she's ever dreamed of. When she comes home. And then there was the fun part about it. I don't know how this would exactly be fun if you're a girl, but evidently it was. And that would be when the groom would go for his bride. And it was like a big party, you know. He'd get a procession together. And it was, I imagine they had, you know, WikiLeaks back then to tip the girl off. You know, he's coming or something like that. You know, Edward Snowden was, you know, sneaking around and or whatever, making sure to leak the information. But the bride had to be ready from the betrothal, from the beginning of the betrothal period until the groom came. She had to be ready to go. In other words, she needed to be packed. She needed to have her wedding garment on. Or so where he's here, he's outside, throw your garment on and go. And so I just think it'd be fun to do it this way. I'm not sure it would be, I'm not sure every girl would think it'd be fun this way, but Charlie, doesn't it sound like a fun way to do a wedding? When you, I'd participate, I promise you. I'd go along, throw rice, throw something, whatever, blow bubbles. But I'd be part of this procession. So he'd come for the bride. And let's go to Matthew chapter 25, and let's just look really quickly at some of the things that are implied in Revelation 19. In verse 9, when the Bible says, "Blessed are they which are called in the marriage supper of the Lamb," and let's just look at what Jesus said, and he's likening the kingdom of heaven here, so I wouldn't say this is too far off from what the Lord Jesus is talking about, would you say? Here we are in Matthew chapter 25, and looking at verse 1. I think we know this account, but it's an account that gives us an illustration of imminence. That is, that Jesus is coming soon, and from our context in Revelation, we recognize that the second coming of the Lord Jesus is not the rapture. It's not when the Lord Jesus takes us up. It's when Jesus comes to set up his kingdom. It's when he comes to deal with the earth. And this is Christ's kingdom. And literally, heaven's coming with him. Literally, the saints of heaven are coming with him. Verse 1 of Matthew chapter 25. "Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish." Why don't they make a song about this, you know? Yeah, they got the, you know, the wise man built his house upon the rock, the foolish man built his house on sand. Why not the wise virgins, you know, filled their lamps full of oil or something, or took extra oil along with them? Anyway, we got the wise and the foolish here. Somebody needs to write a song, so help us out. Somebody sing me a song next week. Tony, can you work on it tonight, maybe? Try to write a good song. The wise virgin, the foolish one. 5 of them were wise, the Bible says, and 5 were foolish. "They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them, but the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept." Well, I mean, get your rest while you can, right? The Bible says at midnight there was a cry made, "Behold, the bridegroom cometh! Go you out to meet him!" Then all the virgins, those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps, and the foolish said unto the wise, "Give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out." But the wise answered, saying, "Not so, lest there be not enough for us and you. But go ye rather to them that sell, and buy for yourselves." And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Afterward came also the other virgins, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he answered and said, "Verily I say unto you, I know you not." And here's what Jesus said, "Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh." Now, I will remind you, the audience to whom Jesus is saying, "Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh." We know who he's saying that to, right? He's saying it to his disciples. He's saying that to people that were part of his earthly ministry. If we were to read Mark chapter 13 and verse 31, where Jesus says, "What I say unto you all, watch." One of the things we're reminded about with regard to the illustration of the kingdom of heaven is that it is sooner than you think, and it is something that you want to be prepared for. Right? Those would be two things we could take away from it. In other words, it'll come sooner than you think, and it's something you want to be ready for. You know, I think this preaches pretty well to a lost person. You see, I've talked to many people who've told me, "Pastor Price, I haven't made sure about my soul. I haven't dealt," and they, whatever terminology they use, "but I haven't dealt with God. I haven't made sure that I know for sure that I know God, that I'm on my way to heaven, that Jesus is my Savior and heaven's my home." I know a lot of lost people that would say, but I've had some of them very confidently tell me, "But when I die and I stand before God, basically we'll have a conversation and we'll work it out then. I know a lot of people that way, probably you do too. People that just think, well, you know what, I'm not sure about it. I mean, honestly, most people are living this way. Lost people normally know there's a God, but most of them are living, realizing that I'm not going to live forever, but things will probably be okay. Things will probably work out. I should pick on baby boomers. We always pick on millennials, right? I should like pick, are you baby boomers? Oh, praise the Lord, we've got some baby boomers. So are you baby boomers? No, you're not? You are? Yeah, oh yeah, good, 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 good. You know, baby boomers, they're the lucky generation, right? They were the children of the great generation, the World War II guys, the World War I and II guys. Baby boomers kind of got caught up. They had John Wayne parents. They had, go to war, fight, and die kind of parents. But actually, baby boomers, my dad's a baby boomer. My dad is so stereotypical for a baby boomer, too, actually. His parents went through the Great Depression. He did not. And that would be a great difference. And so his mom would have been Great Depression. And my grandma's funny because she doesn't need to, but my grandma is just, she saves everything. You know, she'll get rid of things now, but she saves it first before she gets rid of it. You know, it's really funny. I mean, I guess it's genetic, too. You know, she can't pass, like, stuff on the... Well, I can't either, so it is genetic. You know, you can't drive by, somebody's got stuff out in bulk trash, you know. My grandma's got to go sort through it, make sure nobody threw anything. She doesn't need anything. She didn't have room for anything at home. You just got to get rid of it if she gets it. But she's going to make sure to pull something out of the trash or save some, because she's from the Great Depression. And my dad is a baby boomer, and so his parents were in much better shape than what they grew up in, and they raised them rather well. And baby boomers did not prepare for retirement. Did you? Prepare for, good for you. Model baby boomers. Ruining my illustration. But it worked out for them. Everything just went right for the baby boomers. That's kind of what the news has been for the last 10 years. It's like, what are we going to do about the baby boomers? But like their last 15 or 20 years, you know, the things went pretty well in the economy and so forth. And all of a sudden, they were able to retire early. Most of them were earlier than their parents were. And worked out pretty well. These 10 virgins have like the five were good, five were bad. What's the song? Five were good, five were bad. 10 were good, 10 were bad. What's that one? What? 10 were good. Oh, that's the I was deprived as a kid. I didn't have junior church. I sang hymns. I'm sorry. 10 were good, 2 were bad. Yeah, that's the spike. 10 were good. 10 were bad, 2 were good. Thank you. I'm going to make somebody sing it for me, but I wouldn't remember it anyway, so what's the good? Anyway, five are good, five are bad. The five good ones were waiting for the bridegroom. In other words, he's coming. It's going to be a big thing, and we want to be ready. And we don't want to stumble and fall. We want to have good, bright lamps. And so every night, they filled their lamps up, topped them off. This is not like Charlie going on a trip, you know, with his gas tank. It's like me going on a trip. So, I have never run out of gas or diesel. And when I say that, my wife is always like, but you've left the car empty for me plenty of times. You know? But I've never run out of fuel myself. So I've never done it. So I can relate to the good ones. And Charlie can relate to the bad ones. Thank you, Charlie. In other words, Charlie's like, well, you know, I mean, there will probably be a gas station somewhere. No use to stop, and it'll... He's just like the eternal optimist. You know, a lady police officer will come along, give me a ride if I need one, you know. It's going to work out, you know. So, anyway, I don't want to break down. I don't want to get caught somewhere where I'm going to freeze to death or something like that. So I want to have diesel in my car. Charlie would rather, anyway, whatever. It was Tony's fault anyway, wasn't it, Charlie? Right? Actually, yeah, it was. It was Tony's fault.
I'll take the blame for that.
Yeah. So it was driving along.
It was my fault, but it was because of Charlie.
Okay.
He gave me the car with no gas in it. So.
Yeah. All right. So the guy that drove with an empty gas needle. Anyway. The point is this, and to get back to being very, very serious, when the bridegroom comes, that is an event that was scheduled. And God had a plan before the foundation of the world for it, actually. And if you're one of these, I'll show up late and everything will still be fine people, it's not going to be fine. You're going to be locked out. It's going to be too late. Too late. And that's frightening for the lost. I'm frightened for the lost, for those individuals that are not prepared for the bridegroom to come. It's frightening for the believer who isn't preparing for the bridegroom to come as well. You see, we know the day is coming. And we know that this day we live is preparation for that day, don't we? And it's surprising to me how many Christians are just haphazardly going through life without any consideration at all that their days are numbered. And I'm not speaking here of one losing his salvation. I'm not speaking of the opportunity for reward and opportunity to be ready. I can't relate to what a lady must feel like on the day of her wedding. I've only been there. I've never felt like a woman. But I cannot imagine a bride not wanting to be beautiful. Can you? I mean, I do quite a bit of premarital counseling. And it's something I know very, very much. I try to tell guys, sometimes they listen, sometimes they don't. I try to tell them, just do what you got to do for your wedding. It's not about you. I've seen guys like try to have an opinion about their wedding. It's weird. Not just weird, it doesn't work, right? I mean, the truth of the matter is that when the ladies go to the wedding, they're like, oh, look at the groom's colors. Oh, wow, check out the cut of that tux. You know, oh, I like the way he did his hair. No, he probably can't remember unless he looked really, you know, trendy, what the groom looked like at his wedding. Everybody knows what the bride looked like, what she wore, what her colors are, and it's her day. It's her day to put on her garments, and it's her day. She wants to be, if she had to pick the day of her life to be the most beautiful, that's the day of her wedding. We'll already be in heaven, Lord willing. Well, we will when this event occurs. We'll be coming with the Lord Jesus, and we'll be given a white garment. We'll look lovely because of what Jesus has done on our behalf for our sake. But every instance in the Scripture where the bridegroom and the wedding feast is mentioned, there is also mentioned, coupled with it, an urgency for preparedness, an urgency to be ready. And as we go to Revelation chapter 19, as we're there this evening, we must remind ourselves that the things which cannot be known, or the things the Bible doesn't say, are not the emphasis in this portion of the Scripture. But for the second time in Revelation, we're told blessed is. Let's look at that again, shall we? Verse 9. Right. Blessed are they which are called into the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, this is the angel, these are the true sayings of God. Now I ask you, what is the significance of this statement? What is the blessing for those that are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb? Well, the reality of it, my friend, is that we're not lost. We're not locked out. We're not excluded. And literally, we're blessed to be called. And at this point, it isn't a matter of, you know, the kingdom of heaven being like one where the master has a feast and he invites people to come, and some, you know, they have all their reasons or their excuses, and then he says, go out and bring in the blind and the halt and the maim. The blind and the halt and maim are there. My friend, that's a real blessing. Because when you get really practical about it, You and I ought to labor for the Lord Jesus. We ought to live, and we ought to focus, and we ought to look for His coming. Thessalonians 5, we are told that we're not of the darkness, that that day should overtake us as a thief. There are portions of Revelation that teach the same truth. None of these things are going to catch those who know what God says, who believe what God says, and who live for the Lord Jesus by surprise. My friend, I will be no less thrilled having anticipated and looked forward to the marriage supper of the Lamb. It's going to be a wonderful day. And it's a guaranteed day if you know the Lord Jesus as your Savior. My friend, again, the eminent illustration is that everybody there is blessed, obviously, because they're called to this supper. Is it not so? Those who are called there are those who have placed their trust in the blood of Jesus, the cross of Jesus, the promise of God. They're not there because they were part of a particular dispensation. They're there because they have, by faith, received Jesus. From whatever time and age, from whatever vantage point in God's ultimate plan, their perspective is. It's going to be a good day. Concluding this evening, a simple question that must be asked, regardless of the things we assume. My assumption would be that every person here tonight has had a time when you have acted on putting your faith in Jesus. In other words, it's more than just, I believe that there's a God, I believe that Jesus died on the cross, but I have received Jesus as my Savior. I'm trusting God. God with the work of the cross, trusting God's promise, God's Word, for my salvation. And if you have not, my friend, a portion of the Scripture like Revelation 19 is a mighty frightening one. Because the illustration is that those who are not participating in this marriage supper, the Lamb clothed with the white garments that were given to them, that they were allowed to wear, are excluded. And my friend, to be excluded here is to be cast out, to be locked out, to literally be placed in a place of eternal damnation, God's judgment, God's wrath. I'll just tell you something. I'm looking forward to coming kingdom of God, don't you? This isn't it. We're not in God's kingdom right now. This isn't the kingdom of heaven. And I don't want to say unkind words about folks that are under the impression that this is the kingdom, but it isn't. God is, the Holy Spirit is in the world, and He is limiting the power of sin, and He is working and influencing men to receive Jesus. But my friend, there's a prince of the power of the air in this world today. There are individuals who are angels but not God's angels, who are roaming this world. And it's real. There's evil. And the evil is not only the Satan and his angels, but the evil is men who are in unbelief. But yet God can save. The day is going to come, though, that men will be either sealed in their belief or in their unbelief. Death seals those decisions, finalizes those choices. And I would urge everyone here to make sure that your lamps are trimmed and that they're full of oil. In other words, make sure that Jesus is your Savior, God is your Father, heaven is your home. And then be ready. Be in readiness. You know, Jesus is probably going to come soon, don't you think? Probably come tonight. And if not tonight, then probably tomorrow. It's going to be really soon. That's what they thought in the first century church. And that was 2,000 years ago, so it's a lot closer than it was then. And we as believers ought to be ready. Are you ready? You know Jesus as your Savior? Is God your Father? Is heaven your home? And are you living for Him? Are you looking for the coming of Jesus? I've said many times, and I want this to be true for me in my life. When Jesus comes through the sky and we see Him in His glory, when He comes to take us, not the second coming that we see here, this is the second coming. But when Jesus comes and his feet don't touch on the ground and he calls us up, I want to say, I thought so. I knew you were coming. I thought it would be today. Wouldn't that be great? If you're just thinking, you know, Jesus is coming soon, and then you look up and there he is. I like to watch sunsets, and I like to watch sunrises. And each time I see a sunset or a sunrise, I think, Jesus is going to come when I'm looking at one of these one day. And that'd be marvelous, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
But I want to be ready. I want to be living for him. And I want to say, I'm glad you're here. Not, wait a little bit, I've got to get some oil. That's a problem, isn't it? Father, I pray that you'd help us to emphasize what you emphasize in the Scripture. Lord, to make much of what you make much of. And Father, to remove ourselves from controversy or a desire to look into things that simply are not able to be known. God, this marriage supper of the Lamb has a lot of mystery. There's a lot of Passover references or a lot of things that we can see in it. But one of the things that we know for sure is that those that are ready are going to be blessed. And Father, we can be ready. We can be ready. We want to be. Help us to. Remind us to. God, our minds so many times are so weak, and we so often forget things that we ought to be living or practicing or knowing. And I pray that you would help this to become a preeminent truth for us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks. You're dismissed.
And they would have still probably been playing the game like that.